I don't mind.
All right. Yeah, we got it. First time, second time seemed to work. Let's confirm audio.
It's in my whole area.
All right, there we go. Thank you for that. All right, I want to welcome everyone in. Welcome everyone in here with us behind the curtain, so to speak, on Zoom. And those of you looking in live on Facebook and other social media, which this is shared into, and those of you looking in later in the day, later in the week on YouTube. Thank you all for looking in all over the world. Thank you for being here today. I'm Reverend Dr. Stephen J. Kuzmina, here with my First Lady and yours, Tanae K. Kuzmina, to kick us off and share today's daily word. Are you ready to come on out, Tanae, and get us started today?
Yes, I am ready. Today's daily word is faith. Faith, today is Sunday, November 12th, 2023. Faith heals, prospers, blesses, and sustains me. Sometimes I wish I had a way of looking into the future and knowing what to expect. But even though I cannot know how the future might unfold, I can still be prepared for it through the power of my faith. Having faith means I have unwavering fidelity to spiritual truth. My faith is my anchor, keeping me steady during shifting worldly circumstances and focused not on the things of the world, but on the power of spirit. My faith keeps me steadfast in the midst of uncertainty, inventive when met with stagnation, and adaptable when faced with changing circumstances. I turn my attention to God and feel my soul illumined by my belief that everything is working for my good. I align with the truth and go forth blessed by my faith. And from scripture, which is from the 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, we walk by faith and not by sight. Amen.
And amen. Thank you for that, Tanae. We'll switch back over here.
Yep.
And you know what? You might want to be on the trigger, folks, because we're going to do a little Wizard of Oz trivia here. So Tanae, I'm going to ask you if maybe you could monitor the chat there online. We do have a few people on Facebook looking in, and we're going to take a dive in today. And if anybody wants to jump out or just type it in the chat, we're wrapping things up. This is the conclusion of the Spirit of Oz. We've been taking a walk down that yellow brick road, right? This one's titled, There Really Is No Place Like Home. And we spent the last few weeks exploring the unity, new thought teachings found in that classic movie, The Wizard of Oz, and have some fun doing it. And so today we're going to conclude our trip over the rainbow and bring it all home, so to speak, as we look at this concept of home. There really is no place like home. But as I mentioned, before we do, we have a few Wizard of Oz trivia questions for you out there. First of all, what was the name of the horse that drew the carriage that Dorothy and the gang rode? No Googling. That Dorothy and the gang rode it on when they first arrived in Oz. Anybody know what that is?
I don't either.
No? Anybody online there today? No?
Yeah, Mr. Ed.
Mr.
Okay, some close but no cigar. The name of the horse was Sylvester. Sylvester. All right. Sylvester. Okay. Now, where else did that horse appear? Anybody know where else the horse appeared? The horse appeared in Kansas. He belonged to Mr. Marvel or Professor Marvel. Yeah. So that's where else we saw Sylvester, Professor Marvel's horse. All right. Somebody's going to get this one. What song was cut from the movie, then resurrected from the cutting room floor?
Or the rainbow.
Somewhere over the rainbow.
Okay, the Herds. The Herds get a point there. Yeah, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And do you know, the follow-up question is, do you know why it was cut? The producers believe that it slowed down the movie too much. All right, next one. Who was originally cast as the Tin Man?
Allergic to the
cut. Was it Boris Karloff?
No, it was not.
Okay. Sorry. You know?
I can give you a little hint.
Buddy Epson?
Yes, sir. You are absolutely right. I didn't even give you a hint. Very, very good. Oh, and I think I heard you before you said Buddy Epson. I think you answered my next question. And the next question is, why did he withdraw from the role? And what was it you said? Because you were correct on that one, too.
He was allergic to the costume.
Yeah, he got lead poisoning.
Yeah.
From the Tin Man costume. Oh, look at that, John. You're all over this thing.
He is, and all I right. love Trixie's facial expressions.
I've heard that many, many decades after I actually saw the movie, because I was a little bitty kid then.
Yeah, I get it. All right, let's see. We got a couple more here. All right. How many scenes were the wizard and the Good Witch of the North in together? Anybody take a guess how many scenes they were in at the same time?
Zero.
Who said that?
Helen Ann.
Zero. You got that right. Very good. All right. Very good. Yes, they were not in any scenes at the same time together. That doesn't mean they were the same person, because... All right. What was the original color of the ruby slippers? They weren't ruby to begin with. What was the original color?
Oh, I know this one.
Because why? Because you heard me rehearsing?
I did not hear you rehearsing.
I'm going to...
Okay.
It's like one of those things. Huh?
I guess green.
Okay, what do you guess, Danae?
Silver.
Anybody else? Well, it wasn't green. It was indeed silver. That was the original color, the ruby slippers. You know why they were changed to red?
Yeah.
Because they showed up so much better in Technicolor. Remember, it goes from black and white to Technicolor.
Yeah. Our interior decorator, designer, she would have known that answer too.
Yeah, yeah. All right. All right, we got one more. Oh, this is really a good one. How did the author of The Wizard of Oz, Frank Baum, come up with the name Oz? Anybody know where that came from, how that originated? Now, I told you this one tonight. You
did, answer. So I'm going to be quiet.
Anybody else? I don't see anybody waving their hand or unmuting. All right, listen, Frank was telling his children bedtime stories while, you know, prior to writing this and doing this, or at the same time. But his children, he was telling stories about a faraway land, okay? And one day, one of his children asked him, what is the name of the land? So he didn't have one. He starts looking around the room, and on the other side of the room, there was a filing cabinet. In the top drawer had labeled in the little square there, had labeled A to N, and the next filing cabinet door had on it labeled O to Z. So he looked, you know, he was telling the story to his kids. He goes, oh, the land of Oz. So that's where that came from. All right. Okay, here we go. Back in there. Thanks for playing trivia with us today. That'll be the conclusion of today's spiritual nourishment. No, I'm just kidding. All right, enough trivia. Today we look at the idea that there really is no place like home. P.S. Eliot wrote these wonderful lines. He said, "We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and to know the place for the first time." What does that really mean? Well, the story of Dorothy shows us very, very clearly what that means. From the beginning of the story, even before Dorothy goes on her adventure over the rainbow, she is looking to go home, isn't she? Now, obviously, I don't mean physically home because she is already there, but something isn't right. She doesn't really know the place that T.S. Eliot words are talking about. She isn't happy. She isn't fulfilled, satisfied, or loved. She's ignored by Auntie M and Uncle Henry and by everyone else on the farm, and she's gotten herself in trouble with the law. Well, actually, it's Toto is the one in trouble with the law, but Dorothy sets it up as a ploy for attention. So she isn't home, even though she's home. From a metaphysical interpretation, she doesn't know who she is. She is not connected to her inner home, her inner spark, to that divine potential for goodness and greatness that is within her. She isn't awake to or aware of who she is. She's lost God. And so she goes looking for home outside of herself. When she's still in Kansas, she looks for it by running after everyone on the farm to try to get their attention. Then she runs away and looks for it in Professor Marvel, the carny she meets up with. And this is really interesting. Remember after she has the crystal ball experience with Professor Marvel, she decides to go back to her physical home. But she goes back in a lot of fear. She is in fear about Auntie M and getting very fearful about a big storm that is brewing. And what does she find when she gets home? She finds that she's even farther away from really going home than before, as the closed doors to the storm cellar symbolize. Her fears have moved her farther away from knowing who she really is, from really going home. And she's left out in the storm, seemingly all alone. So her exploration continues, this time as a journey to Oz. And Dorothy once again looks outside herself to try to get home. This is a really pointed lesson of how we might get through one experience only to have it show up again, this time in Technicolor, so that perhaps this time we'll get the message that our soul is trying to give us. We're always in the process of awakening, and every event in our life has the potential to serve as a catalyst for that awakening. Whether we allow it or not is up to us. But if we don't allow it, then we get to have more similar experiences, and we don't get to move on, is what I'm trying to say. So perhaps the next time in Technicolor, perhaps the next time more intense, perhaps the next time in a different way, right? In Oz, Dorothy still doesn't wake up. And she looks to a pretty shady character, the wizard, to take her home. She continues to look to him even after Toto reveals him to be a fraud. She thinks he will get her home. The wizard promises to take her back to Kansas in his balloon, but it is only after the balloon takes off without Dorothy does the wizard reveal that he doesn't know how to work it. In Kansas, Dorothy is looking outside of herself for home. In Oz, she is looking outside of herself for home. But when Glinda tells her, "You've always had the power to go back to Kansas," in that moment, Dorothy awakens to and begins to trust her own power, her own inner spark, her innate goodness, and her own potential for greatness. In that moment, she begins to find herself within herself. She begins to know herself for the first time. But she doesn't go home yet. She has something important to do. She has to stop and say goodbye to each of her companions. Perhaps it is much, much more than merely saying goodbye. Perhaps in those sweet, intimate moments of connection with the scarecrow, the lion, and the one she'll miss the most, as she whispered, the Tin Man, she wasn't just saying goodbye. Perhaps she was integrating their qualities within her. She told each of them she couldn't have done this without them. And that's right. To be awake to our true selves, to go home, there has to be an integration of divine intelligence, divine love, divine strength and power. To put a spiritual spin on it, in those moments, Dorothy finds God, who, by the way, has been there all along, symbolically hanging around in a pink bubble. She feels God. She sees God. The God that is closer than her hands and feet, nearer than her breath, and the God that is everywhere. Glinda explains that she did not share this truth with Dorothy earlier because Dorothy wouldn't have believed her. She had to learn it for herself, which goes back to one of last week's Ruby Slipper lessons. Remember, we are let alone, not left alone, to discover who we are. And just to expand for a moment on that idea from last week, self-awareness cannot really be taught. It must be gained from experience. As the Zen poet Jeremy Wolfe so eloquently wrote, experience isn't the best teacher. It's the only teacher. Ernest Holmes says, he takes it a step further by saying it's not just experience, but bitter experience that is often our teacher. He said that when he wrote, "We give intelligence outlet either by pure inspiration and intuition or by the way of bitter experience. And with most of us, it is usually through the latter." Dorothy certainly went through some bitter experiences, right? But the awakening came, the integration came through her experiences. And then one thing remained to take her home. She needed to trust that she had the ability to go home, and she needed to activate that trust by clicking her heels. Powerful metaphysical statement for us. We need to trust that we are divine, and we need to trust that a divine law is always at work, activated by our word. Ernest Holmes said something about this too. He said, we should be careful not to divide our mental house against itself. Having announced the law of liberty, we must not deny it. And I found something that lines up with that in scripture too, coming from James chapter 1, verse 25, which says, and this is an accurate paraphrase of what Ernest Holmes said, or probably is vice versa, but those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. This is talking about being in alignment, being in harmony, thought, word, in action, what we're believing in, that liberty, that freedom to choose what our experiences will be. Going home and knowing the place for the first time takes some trust. It takes an integration of love, intelligence, and power. And it takes an awareness of our inner spark, our innate goodness and greatness. Going home is about walking that spiritual path of self-discovery, following the yellow brick road to discover the inner spark.
Follow the yellow brick road.
We will deliver, Ernest Holmes said, we will deliver ourselves from sickness and trouble in exact proportion to our discovery of ourselves and our true relationship to the whole. So I want to wrap things up today with doing a meditation, doing the November meditation that we find in unity. So I want you to integrate some of these things we've talked about over the last few weeks. We want you to listen as you are entering into your meditation, closing your outer eyes if it's safe for you to do so. If you're looking in on Facebook or YouTube later, don't do this if you're driving or watching small children or older children or senior citizens or anything that requires your attention. But I want you to look for, as we move through this meditative peace and prayer this morning, to recognize and integrate that scarecrow, that divine intelligence, to look for and listen for what the qualities that we find in the Tin Man, that divine love and the infinite strength and power that we see in the Lion, and the power for goodness and greatness that's represented by those ruby slippers. Okay. So we want to do this today. So I invite you to close your outer eyes if you're comfortable with doing that. I will see if we can maybe put a little music in here. Not sure what that'll work. Let's see here. It looks like it's popping up today. So, all right, let's take a deep breath together. And center ourselves in this moment of right here, right now. And in this stillness, in this time of prayer and focus and meditation, we unify our mind with the divine mind. We acknowledge the indwelling, pervasive presence and power, God. Connecting with and including one another, we become one, one voice, one message, uplifting the world in prayer. And we start with what we talk about here in the month of November. We begin with gratitude. Allow these words to be the words of your heart. Let us affirm, my every thought is in harmony with divine love. My every thought is in harmony with divine love. As I quiet my mind in prayer, I envision every thought bathed in divine love. The harmonizing power. Thoughts transform in the presence of harmonizing love. I am able to see a way where I thought there was no way. I am able to hold my heart open in generosity. I am able to lean into the good and the just in a spirit of harmony. We affirm, God is the health in every cell and system of my body. God is the health in every cell and system of my body. God is, and therefore I am. I am divine life. I am whole in body, mind, and spirit. I become aware of the flow of life throughout my body as my heart beats in perfect rhythm with the pulse of life. Every cell is receptive and responsive to the ever-renewing power of divine life. Let us affirm. My mind is steady, unwavering in spiritual strength. My mind is steady, unwavering in spiritual strength. Situations may come and go, or circumstances may change from day to day. All the while, I stand steady by the power of spiritual strength. God is my strength, and therefore I am strong. I need not react to life's changes with resistance or defensiveness, for I hold to the truth that is my freedom. And we affirm, in every matter, I am guided by infinite intelligence. In every matter, I am guided by infinite intelligence. I have instant access to wisdom and understanding as I turn within. Every concern directed to divine wisdom transforms into guidance. Divine intelligence is an ever-present inner resource that I count on in matters small and large. Wisdom and understanding guide my way. And we affirm, I am a radiating center of spiritual peace and confident living. I am a radiating center of spiritual peace and confident living. At the core of my being, I am peace. My peaceful mind swiftly calms turbulent thoughts so that I think clearly. My peaceful heart generously embraces my human family. In peace, I flow from moment to moment with purpose, passion, and persistence. I am divine peace. And as we come back to familiar surroundings and as we close this session of prayer, we breathe a deep breath of appreciation for the truth that renews and refreshes us. Knowing our oneness with God and knowing our divine faculties of harmony, life, love, strength, and wisdom, we peacefully proceed into the hours ahead and the day ahead. Let's conclude together with something we haven't done here for a while, our prayer for protection. The light of God surrounds us. I am light. The love of God enfolds us. I am love. The power of God protects us. I am power. The presence of God watches over us. I am presence. Wherever we are, God is. I am divine. And so it is, and so we let it be. Amen. All right. Everybody here on Zoom, hang in here, and we're going to share some things, share a little bit. I want to thank everyone looking in on social media, on YouTube, Facebook, and wherever else this is streamed. I want to thank you for being here. Remember, Morning Inspiration 7 days a week and always live on Facebook, 9 a.m. Central Time on Sundays. And next week we have a treat. We have Reverend Glory Cato coming out and sharing the message next week. We're going to wrap things. Well, Glory, if you want to come out right now while we're still on social media and let everyone know what you're going to be sharing about next week, that would be wonderful. And then I'll conclude the feed and we can visit a little bit more with each other here on Zoom. And don't forget social media. If you want to join us behind the curtain, so to speak, you can subscribe to our newsletter where you'll get the link and the code to get in here, where we carry it on a little bit more and have some fellowship and have some discussion after the service where we're not broadcasting to the world. But come on out, Glory, and share with us what you're going to do next week. And then the week after that, we're going to have Tanae come out. So I get a little bit of break and I get to take in the wisdom of the ladies. What's up, Reverend Glory?
Hey, Reverend Stephen, thank you so much. I love the message. And next week, I thought it would be interesting to up-level our self-care. And this has been something that has been near and dear to my heart, about moving into a deeper level of spiritual self-care. And that is actually part of the path towards God, or back towards our home, as you were talking about today with the wonderful Wizard of Odd parable. So I'm excited to be speaking and sharing with you all Sunday, and see you then.
Yeah, that sounds wonderful. I am absolutely ready to take in something like that. In fact, that is the reason you two are doing the next couple Sundays, so I can participate in some of that self-care. So I look forward to taking in your wisdom around all that. And so everybody else, make sure you mark your calendar. Reverend Glory Cato, the new Reverend Glory Cato, right here live on Facebook next week at 9. I'm going to wrap up the feed here. Stay tuned on Zoom and we'll continue the discussion. Goodbye, everybody in social media land. We'll see you next time.